There we go.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, everyone. I'm James Wesley.
I am Seth Rudetsky, and together we are...
Married?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know what that means.
I don't know. I thought we'd have a fun... the point is, this is Stars in the House. Stars in the House is a show that we do twice a day.
Yes.
For...
the Actors Fund.
Yeah, for the Actors Fund. Basically, to put people in a good mood. But also, yes, if you can, we'd like you to donate to the Actors Fund. We have a brand new thing we're going to be doing tonight. So start donating.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead, Seth.
Well, I guess I can say... Well, I'm going to wait till we get a little bit in.
Well,
let's first see what the Actors Fund is.
The Actors Fund is an organization that helps people, especially at this time in our country's history, in the world's history, helping professionals in the performing arts from coast to coast, everywhere in between. If you're someone who depends on... the performing arts, whether you're a wedding singer or a dance teacher, or you work in an opera, you work in an artistic director's office, behind the scenes, in front of the scenes, and you need help paying your rent, buying some food, paying an insurance premium, the Actors Fund is there to help you. And that's why we're here.
Correct the mundo.
Right.
So I just added...
Oh, put the banner on, Seth. So.
Oh, yeah. Well, I just added this little thing.
Oh, what did you
It's put? Such a busy banner. But here's the thing. Well, just that way people know. Well, so here's the deal. We're going to ask it again.
Right.
So donate to StarsInTheHouse.com. We have a new method where we're going to have people read who donated. So once you donate at StarsInTheHouse.com, you're going to get something back from the Actors Fund being like, thanks for donating $20. Forward that thanks to StarsInTheHouse2020@gmail.com. And then we're going to get them. And then we're going to have someone from China Beach read them in their character. I don't know how that's going to make any difference. But it's going to be
fun. This isn't Frozen, Seth.
Yes, it is. Dana Delany is going to use your character voice. Speaking voice, if that's you like.
Oh my gosh.
This is a dedication to China Beach. So here's the deal. This is basically like me with SCTV. When I did SCTV,
this is true.
I was in a
what
full
Seth
panic.
Is about to say.
Because I'm obsessed with SCTV, panicking, sweating, so excited.
And because Seth talks really fast. SCTV.
Yes, SCTV, Second City Television. I was freaking out because I love the show so much. So now I've transferred all that nervous energy and excitement and craziness and sweatiness and red chestness to James Wesley. He's obsessed with China
Why?
Beach.
Because I've seen, you know what I realized? Because Dana Delany, yes, Emmy Award winner for China Beach, not once, but twice.
We're aware of her work.
We were talking a little bit before, and I was like, I'm so nervous. Look at my chest. It's like red. And why is that? Well, one, I'm a fan of the show, but I've been fans of other shows, including Desperate Housewives.
But you're a psycho fan of the show.
Well, but you know what I think it is? I think it's because this show came on the air when I was 19 years old, the same age as Julie. And that's such a formative age, you know, and Dana's character was all about, you know, she was a nurse in a world that was really dominated by men, which is one of the reasons I love the show, is that it may be the first show that was dealt with war that came from a women's perspective. And being gay, though not being out yet, I think I related more, you know what I mean? And about to embark on my life that I didn't know what it would be at that point. And China Beach was like the show that I watched and I followed and fell in love with all the characters for all 4 years it was on the air. So I told Dana, I said, I may not be able to do anything and she may have to take over the entire show.
Here's
and
a lot
I'll
of
just
notes.
Sit here. It's and like this.
I love them going, remember the time you, and then that's
like
it.
This.
Anyway, by the way, we already got an email. People are doing it. So you donated.
Oh, excellent.
You donated Stars in the House.
We are here for Actors Fund, not just for my own enjoyment.
Yeah, so selfish. StarsInTheHouse.com, and then you email StarsInTheHouse2020@gmail.com, the donation slip. And like I said, Dana Delany in full character costume will be bringing the donations.
You know what? Here's the thing. Because Seth did not see the show, I'm going to out him right now, but that's okay. You just graduated what from like
Oberlin, like Nancy.
Yes.
Oberlin grad. Hey, Nance.
Exactly.
We'll talk about that later. Daskam.
But I believe that it's available like on Hulu or Amazon or something. And we're going to watch it. I'm going to watch it all over again. And you're going to see how easy it was for me to get hooked on the show. In the meantime, we want to give a shout out to some people who gave earlier today to the Actors Fund, because we think like the average donation is like $35 is what we're kind of guesstimating here. It's really incredible. We keep saying it in these times that people donate.
It's really
to
incredible.
The Actors Fund. It's incredible. So we want to give a shout out to just a few people. Lisa from California, who donated $50. Jessica from California, $25. Michelle from Illinois, $50. Mark from New Hampshire, $25. I don't think we've had someone that I've read out loud, New Hampshire.
About
Mark
time.
From New Hampshire, $25. Merle from New Jersey, $50. Linda from Pennsylvania, $50. Annette from California, $100. DV from Alabama, $100.
Wow.
And Duffy from New York, $100. And that adds up in our 5 weeks to $238,500 raised for the Actors Fund.
So yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. We're seeing applause from Michael. Okay, so we're going to have China Beach. We're going to have a special John LaPook segment. But don't forget, if you donate, starsandhouse.com, email starsandhouse2020@gmail.com. Okay, James, let the obsession begin.
Okay, so because of our platform, everyone who knows this, StreamYard is great, but there is a limit to how many people you can have on the screen. So as much as everyone calls it Zoom, it isn't Zoom. Zoom, you have like 100 people.
But it's not live stream.
You can't live stream Zoom. Believe me, if we did, we just got a notification saying the studio is full. LaPook, you might have to go out and come back in.
Yeah, LaPook.
At 8:20. There you go.
There you
see,
goes.
John LaPook has been with us so much. He knows the drill. He just follows the directions. So we're going to do this piecemeal, and I just kind of did this randomly. So we're going to have four people. Seth, are you going to... I think I did my research, 300 different songs that were used over the course of 4 years,
recordings. That we could be sued for playing?
Yeah. So the title song is so iconic and so set the tone for it. This show would be cut off if we actually played the Supremes. So Seth instead is going to do his very best at kind of imitating what the opening was.
It sounds horrible on piano, but just like go along with the game.
Go along with it. Those of you who are fans. And so hold on, we're going to start here, Seth. Go ahead. You go ahead. You just get started here. There we go. All right. So with that in mind, we're going to get on Dana Delany.
Yeah.
Hi, Dana.
Hey.
And Jeff.
Hi. Oh, my gosh.
There we go.
I can see you.
I actually think that Brian was trying to get on, and Dr. LaPook took his spot.
Not good.
So hopefully Brian will get on now. So when he comes on, we'll get started, Dana, and then I'm sure that Brian will be on shortly.
Great.
Thanks, Dana, for making this happen.
Sure. I do want to say, because you were talking about the music rights,
yeah,
the reason why it wasn't available for a long time was because nobody knew that, DVDs would be around, that you would have to pay in perpetuity and all that sort of thing. So you can only watch the show by buying the DVD set at this point that Time Life owns.
Oh.
It's a little retro because they paid for all the music rights, which cost them a lot of money. Yeah.
So you can't see it streaming right now. You'd have to get the DVD.
No, you have to buy the full set from Amazon, who's a little backed up right now.
Okay. Yeah, right. Okay. It's not exactly essential buying, but it may be pretty soon the way that we're like self-quarantined here, so we'll go. Dana, I already told you how much I love the show, so I may need you to introduce me to two of your and everyone else, two of your co-stars here.
Okay. Jeff Kober, right there, who what was your character's name, Jeff?
Dodger.
What would you want to say about him?
Well, he didn't really talk much, so
that's true. He was the silent type.
He was the man. He's the man who had seen too much.
Yes, that's right. The 1,000-yard stare. And then we have Michael Boatman, who played Beckett, who was the head of Graves, which was the morgue.
Oh, Michael.
Is he muted?
No, we didn't mute him. We would never mute Michael.
There we go.
There you are.
You got it, Michael.
My mic was working. I did it? Okay.
Yeah, you did it.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, Michael.
Thank you so much. Hi, Jeff. I love you both.
I love you.
I love James and Seth because you're helping actors. What a wonderful thing.
Awesome
on the piano, by the way.
I still got it.
Audra's going to get the good fight going at some point soon. If James doesn't kill her first. Having a baby running around, but that'll be another day. But Michael, I'll start with you simply because Dana reminded me that this was like early on in your career. How was this like your first TV show?
Yeah, it was. I was 22 or 23, I think, when I got that show.
What did you think?
And now I'm 55. How did that happen? How does that even happen? It doesn't seem possible. And Delany looks exactly the same, which
right?
is so.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, baby.
So how, Dana? So I know, but I can't see Dana if I don't wear the glasses. Right, Seth, I gotta see the cast.
You know what I look like.
The glasses work. The glasses do work.
Okay. Oh, thank you, Jeff. See.
Yeah.
Thank you. Ass kisser.
Uber fan. Uber fan.
So okay. So, no doubt that the writing is amazing. The everything about the show was great. But I mean, did you all of you have to go in an audition? Like, how did it begin? And what did you think when you read the script for the first time?
I read the script and I thought I'd never read a part written for a woman like that. It was like a man. It was written, and I pictured when I went into audition, I played it like Clint Eastwood would play it. I just pictured Clint Eastwood. I found out later that the writer John Sacred Young had pictured Henry Fonda, which is good too, you know, all American stoic. But yes, I had a very now well-known, long drawn out testing. A lot of people did not want me. It went on and on.
Hey, famously. Wait, details. What do you mean well-known?
Hold on, there we go.
Whoa. Looking good. But who didn't want you? Who the hell didn't want you?
ABC, a few ABC executives did not want me because they didn't think I was pretty enough.
Yikes.
And they made me do screen tests. And I can say it now because she's won an Oscar. It was between me and Helen Hunt in the end.
Oh.
And she's done just fine.
Yeah, it worked out.
And by the way, you look pretty sexy here. Where are
you? That was Rolling Stone.
Wow.
But yeah, and I have to say the ABC executive did write me a letter of apology a couple years later and said that he was wrong. So he didn't have to do that. So that was pretty big of him.
Nice.
Right.
Yeah.
What about you, Jeff and Michael? How was your experience getting on the show?
My experience, I was Jeff. You want to go?
No, I want you to go, Michael.
I'm a little delayed.
Because I haven't heard this story.
I don't know that there's much of a story. I was living in New York in a basement apartment, you know, doing the young, struggling actor thing. And I got, I was working as a security guard for New York Telephone, believe it or not. I don't even think New York Telephone even exists anymore.
I mean, yeah. You know,
yes, guarding New York Telephone buildings on the midnight to eight shift so I could audition during the day. Which to me was just one of the best ways to see New York because I got to see New York after dark, you know, which is back in the 80s, it was quite a thing. It was a wonderful, horrible, great, amazing place, especially for a young actor. But I've been auditioning around, and this is such a I feel like I'm the Wizard of Oz here. I'm like looming over the camera. I've been auditioning around, and I got a call from my agent that there was a show, a Vietnam War show, told from the perspective of women, which I thought was great.
Yeah.
And I read the script, and they're just special. There's just certain scripts that are just immediately special. You just know that something is going to happen, you know. And this was one of them. That time, I certainly didn't have the confidence to think that I was going to get the part of Sam Beckett, who's, you know, my character that I played. But I just remember wanting to really do a good job, and wanting to really just throw my energy at it as powerfully as I could. And so, you know, I went in and I auditioned, and I think I had like two callbacks before we had to do the whole, like, go to the network and go to the studio. And, but that involved me flying out from New York, like on probably a Friday or something, testing, in front of ABC and like getting the part, like right there. John Levy, who was the casting director, ran out after me. I guess they decided right then and there.
Oh.
And I don't remember who was up for it, but I'm sure there were familiar, you know, faces, because a lot of my friends, guys that I hung out with at the time and are still good friends, like Don Cheadle and Courtney Vance, who I was in Hamburger Hill with before that, had also auditioned. I mean, like, you know, Jeff and Dana know, you kind of, you know, you meet your friends and your enemies when you're auditioning, and the ones that are able to kind of hang out and when you get a part that they want tend to be, I think, your best, not your best friends, but your real friends.
Let me ask you something, Michael. Have you ever been up for a part that your friend wasn't up for and you actually called your friend and he said, "I'd swing in for something and I think you'd actually be really right for it"?
No, I haven't, but I have been up for parts where friends were being considered, and when they got it, I was actually happy for them. I mean, because I get it. It's harder for me if I see a part that, you know, which has actually happened, where, you know, I was in some film that I auditioned for, and a famous rapper at the time, who will remain nameless, but a famous rapper at the time got the part, and it was like, no, it makes no sense. It's easier for me when it's a friend of mine, because I can, A, if I can't be happy for myself, I can at least be happy because I know this really, you know, good actor, buddy of mine, you know, got the gig, so.
That's nice.
I don't know if that's crazy or not.
Hey, Dana, before we get to Jeff, can you let Brian know that we have a spot for him? Because I have a feeling that he tried to get in.
And
I just got a text from Brian. He's on the road. He's trying to get somewhere where he can dial in.
Oh, it's so Brian.
Where is he? Okay. Is he in Utah? Oh, my God.
Yeah, he's in
Utah. Sometime in the next hour, he could just pop. He could just pop on.
They have Wi-Fi there.
Do they?
I'm not sure.
I know they do.
Hey, Jeff.
Yes.
Dana was telling me about a special trip that the two of you took together at the end of the first season. I'd love to hear it, because I mean, had any of you been to Vietnam before? I mean, especially then, probably not, right?
Vietnam opened for tourism in July of that year. I think it was 87, 88. And we were the first Westerners that a lot of these people had ever seen. Wow. One of the first things that we had to learn to say was, "Kom phai lien so to la mei," which means I'm an American. I'm not a Russian, I'm an American. Wow. Because the Russians had been there for 10 years and they didn't tip well and they were rude. And so people would look at us and then we would say that and they would go, "Oh, okay," and invite us in. Except one woman came up to me. "Do you remember this, Dana?" She said, "Why you eat people?" I said, "I'm sorry." She said, "Why you eat people?" I said, I don't eat people." She said, "You're American, aren't you?" So there were still, most people said, "That's in the past. We want to move forward from here. Americans are our friends." But there were a few people still that everyone there had lost family members. Everyone, virtually everyone of a certain age. So,
you know, it's funny because I, you know, having watched the show when I was 19, it seemed like the Vietnam War was so much earlier. But now looking back, you went there only like 14 years after the show began, only 13 years after the end of the war. Yeah. Really, like you said, Jeff, it wasn't everyone knew people.
Yeah, it was. There were still in Hue where they had the massive Tet Offensive battle, the battle for Hue. There's still bullet holes everywhere. I mean, there was and bomb craters and just, it was there was still lots of evidence.
Do you remember we went to the orphanage and there were all those kids that were clearly had Agent Orange and they all had birth defects?
And they also were almost all half American.
Yeah.
And mixed race in Vietnam means you don't exist.
Right.
Back then, at that time.
Yeah.
Dana, why did the two of you decide to go?
Because we're adventurous.
I love it.
And there was a writer's strike.
Oh, and so, God, I forgot that. Yeah.
So we weren't going to start up in July, and so we had time on our hands.
But we had this great adventure because we ended up being paired in a little private tour with this guy named Bill Stevenson, who it turned out was there to meet with spies, I guess. He was trying to get information about MIAs and he was writing a book about it. And it was called Kiss the Boys Goodbye. Is that what it was called? Or I think he wrote the book afterwards.
Yeah,
we're in the book. But we were watched constantly.
This is the best story. We were in Saigon, Ho Chi Minh City. And by this time, we had gotten to see the dirty underbelly of Vietnam. And we saw the spies following us. And I went into my room one afternoon, I had sent in some laundry and hadn't come back. And I said, "Geez, how long does it take to get your laundry around here?" 10 seconds later, the phone rang. "You want laundry?" Yeah, please. And I went and told Bill and Dana, and they said, "Nah, that was a coincidence." So I sent out some more laundry right away. Next day, I went back and said, gosh, they really don't do laundry very fast around here. The phone rings. You want laundry? So,
wow.
So, yeah. Jeff, you thought they were spies. They were actually maitre d'.
They wanted to make sure we were taken care of.
Wow. Wow. They were there to hook you up, and you accused them of spying. You know what? I remember that story, but why did you... Did you guys go before we shot the pilot, or...?
No, after the first 6 episodes.
Oh, that's right. Oh, my gosh.
Because you guys were a spring replacement, right? Is that what?
Yeah, we were mid-season.
Mid-season.
Oh, mid-season replacement. That's right.
I was a guest star on the pilot.
Oh my God, you were so good.
I wasn't even a regular. I never tested.
You never did?
Well, thank you. They did, though. They realized after they did the pilot, they said, "You know what? We don't have any servicemen in this show, so why don't we bring that guy back?"
So, I tell you guys that all these years later. All these years later, my wife is still obsessed with Jeff Cober. She just thought you were the sexiest. Oh, my God, those eyes, Myrna. That voice.
Oh, come on. Thank you.
Yeah, great. No, thank
that
you.
That made my day.
Yeah.
Hold on, let's
thanks
be real life.
For creating and, oh, look.
Look at see? That.
Oh.
The man of China Beach.
That's right.
Boatman, you look like a baby.
He was.
We were all babies, for God's sake. You, none of you were. What? Okay, so if I was 23, we can. It's all out. How old were you then?
I was 30. 30.
No.
Yeah, I was old, man.
I was 31.
Yeah, I was 33. I think 34, like that.
All right.
But I was a guy who was supposed to be 19, but it seemed too much. So the years helped.
So it made sense.
It made sense.
Yeah. Hey, Dana, can you check your email? I sent you a list of donations to read.
Oh, my God, yes.
Wimmer says he'll be there within 10 minutes.
Where is he going?
He's probably
I just see him tearing through
fly
the
fishing.
Yeah, exactly. I just see him tearing down some country road in Utah. I'm assuming he's in Utah.
So everybody listening, when you donate to Stars in the House, then you send your little donation sheet to starsinthehouse2020@gmail.com, and we can have a fabulous China Beach cast member like Dana Delany read it. By the way, Dana, when you're on Zoom, you can make a fake background in back of you. Your house looks like the fake background on Zoom.
I know, right?
It is fake.
Oh,
that's
nice.
Hysterical.
Okay, oh, by the you way, ready?
Yes, you're ready.
Go. Yes, okay. Lexi from Kentucky, 3575. Get that 75 cents in, excellent. Charlene from Clearwater, Florida, 25. Patrick from New Jersey, 5150. Nancy from Georgia, 123.59. Amanda from Illinois, is this like a tip or something? I'll just round it up, 26. Jamie from LA, 26. Kira from New York City, 25. Nancy from Virginia, 52. Ruth, I know Ruth. Ruth from Canada, 100. Christina from Minnesota, 25. Julie from Indiana, 26, who has been watching Stars in the House from the beginning. And, oh, thank you. She watched China Beach for the entire run. And Abby. I know Abby from Pittsburgh, $75 in honor of Dana Delany, who's been such an inspiration in my life. I have to tell you, Abby watched the show when she was, I believe, maybe 9 or 14, maybe 12, somewhere around there, 12. She wrote me a letter back then. I answered her, and we've been pen pals ever since.
Aww.
And she just came to see me. She's come to see me in a play in New York. She just came to see me in a play in New Jersey in January.
Aww.
She's great.
Wow. That's so great, everyone.
While we're waiting for Brian to find Wi-Fi or pull over, why don't we bring on Nancy, and we'll bring on Robert because we have enough room here. Here we go, Nancy.
Yay!
Hi!
Hi!
Nice.
It's so great to see your faces.
You guys are so beautiful.
You're so beautiful.
You
I feel like
are
every, I feel
so
like
beautiful.
I feel like everybody has figured out this this multi-meeting situation. I'd never heard of things like this until until the virus. And now all of a sudden it's here we are. It's just pretty amazing.
Here, we got some pictures here. Let's get the show here.
Yeah, see if you remember these photos.
Hold on.
Wait, who am I echoing back?
I think it might be Mike.
Uh-oh, so what do I do? I have earphones in.
What if you don't wear the earphones? Will it not echo?
It's not echoing. Should I just turn it off?
Yeah, maybe probably. Turn it off.
Okay.
We'll show.
Wow, look at that.
Oh my God.
Nice round, Nancy.
Nancy's right in the middle. I love it.
Which one am I?
Okay,
I don't remember.
I can see it's Clint Eastwood. You were doing Clint Eastwood in that picture, Dana. I saw it.
Nancy, are you just like listening to music this whole time and ignoring us?
No, actually, I was inspired by seeing that other people sent old photos. So I was scrolling through my phone trying to send you a couple.
Oh, you can send?
Yeah, I did. I managed to get your emails, but I think I got it to you, Dana, and Michael. And then you said, we're going to bring Nancy on. So I was like, oh,
darn it.
I'm
going to check.
I'll get to the rest of you.
Give me 5 minutes on Oberlin. First of all, where did you live?
I lived in Burton for 2 years.
Beautiful.
And then I lived off campus. But you were there after me because I graduated in 81.
Yeah, I graduated late 80s.
But I worked the Dascom lunch crowd Monday, Wednesday, Fridays, and it was grim.
When you say worked, what do you mean, Nancy?
Well, Dascom was a big cafeteria. Okay, Michael, that's really fun. I dropped my side and showed them a bra strap. What do you
know? Yeah, baby.
No one wore bras at Oberlin.
Or shaved their armpits.
Those were the days. No, I served up food for lunch. I was like the lunch cafeteria line server. And once I keeled over and fainted. And for one day, the rumor on campus was, she's pregnant! And then that ended.
What was your actual major?
Creative writing major, Black Studies minor.
Yes, queen.
No, yas, queen.
Yeah, thank you.
Since I've got five of you, since I can't have all of you on, what was like a typical week like? Did you have table readings? Where did you film? Because it all looks so real.
Did we ever have a table reading? I don't remember one.
No, we had no time.
No. I don't remember.
We did at lunch sometimes out at Indian Dunes. We would sit and read.
I do remember vague something like that, like maybe one time or a couple of times having one at Indian Dunes.
Yeah. We were famous for having the longest days in
can't
show
hear
business.
Bob.
We had
That's
a,
right.
Can't hear me?
Bob. We can hear you.
Michael's the one having problems. Maybe put it back in, Michael. I know.
It's
not always you, a troublemaker, and you're Michael.
It's Michael, it's not Bob.
It's not me. You can hear me.
Yeah,
Bob, all right.
Bob, you're perfect.
I love to hear
you. Hear me now?
Tell them about the t-shirt.
Oh, yes. We did have we had one 24-hour shooting day, and then they couldn't even shoot the next day, and the crew printed up a t-shirt. I'm not going to mention the director's name, but it did say, I survived, and then the director's name. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
We were legendary, actually. It took a while, let's say, to get the show on pattern, I think, as the studio executives are fond of saying. It took, because of the, you know, shooting in Indian Dunes, because of weather issues. I mean, the set got washed away during the pilot. Wow. There were different things that didn't happen on a normal studio, you know, television series. So, it took a while.
They also innovated a lot of moving camera kind of things.
Yeah, we were the first ones to use a Steadicam before ER. We did
the same thing. ER stands on our shoulders. That's what happened.
That's true. That's actually true.
Wait a minute. So how much was done at Dunes? Like how much was done on location? How much was done at Warner Brothers?
Well, that changed from season to season, right? I mean, because we did much more at the Dunes the first season than thereafter.
Yeah. I think most of the interior scenes were at Warner Brothers, right? Yeah.
Yeah, right, I know all of my scenes at the GRU were done at Warner Brothers. Was it Stage 9?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
But our showrunner, John Segret Young, was famously a perfectionist. So we really never got over 18, 20-hour days. That was pretty much the whole.
We also went through the color wheel on the scripts twice once.
Oh, my God.
Twice.
In other words, every different color was a script change. Oh, my God, I forgot about that. When you said we went through the color wheel, Jeff, for a second I was thinking, well, Michael and me, but what?
How dare you?
Oh, you always got to go there, Giles.
I do.
They brought Nancy in for that purpose, actually. It's true.
And you know what? What's funny is you guys were talking about your auditions, and I realized I auditioned during the writer's strike. So they didn't have a script. They couldn't legally bring a script. So I just ran my mouth and they filmed it. And then they had me come back again. And I ran my mouth about another stuff.
But did they know that you could sing, Nancy? Did they know that you could sing?
Not really. I mean, they knew I do comedy and improv and stuff, but I didn't sing for them or anything. And then
you sang great.
Yeah, that was fun. Yeah. Except that one time with that Baldwin brother. That wasn't so fun.
Oh, yeah.
Let's try to keep the show positive, Nancy. Positive. Hold on.
Sorry.
Wait, there was a Baldwin on our show?
Which brother?
The one that's now sort of a religious right winger.
I went to camp with him. I went to music camp with him.
You two have a lot in common.
Nancy, we have the same childhood. We got to talk
about it. I know, right?
When you auditioned, did they just say, they gave you a situation and you just yes-ended it?
No, it wasn't. I guess when I said improv, they just asked me questions. We just talked about stuff and I told them some of the stuff that I was doing. And yeah, it was stuff. Listen, the week before my first audition for China Beach, I got money from the Actors Fund to live because I couldn't pay my rent. So it was one of those serendipitous things, honest to God.
You hear that, everybody?
Thank you, Actors Fund.
Everybody watching, the Actors Fund is there when you need them.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so wonderful.
I got 2 months of Actors Fund myself. Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
When did you go to them for help, Jeff?
It was in the, I think it was like early 80s, mid 80s. Yeah.
You know, it's because Susan Clutchy Watson, you know, who's on This Is Us. She said right before This Is Us, she really needed help and she went to the Actors Fund. It's interesting, like so many, I know it isn't, you're actors, so that's why you're saying it helps. And we know that it helps everyone that's in the performing arts, but it is fascinating the number of people that we've talked to who right before they got something, they were down and out and they needed help.
Yeah.
And the Actors Fund was there for them. Oh my gosh, I did not expect that two of you would be saying that. Wow.
Hey, now I have a question. Is the Actors Fund connected to, can you guys hear me? Okay. Is it connected to the home where actors live, you know?
Yes, in New Jersey.
Retired actors.
There's the one that's in LA, right? And then there's one that's in Inglewood, New Jersey.
So, that's right. I heard about the one in Inglewood. Oh, I forgot about that.
Yeah,
the fund covers a lot of stuff. It helps those, and it also helps with these grants because they're not loans; they're money that they give you outright. You know,
that's right.
You just have to show them bills or stuff like that. But yeah, it covers. It's the actors' version. I mean, the theater actors' version of the motion picture fund for film actors because they do similar stuff.
But it's for everybody though. But it's Actors Fund, you can go to them if you're a best boy, if you're a script supervisor, if you're an
a wedding teacher, singer, whatever. Yeah,
anything. And just on a side note, what's been going on with a lot of actors, we're talking about actors, is they didn't have enough weeks in equity and they had jobs that were going to give them equity weeks, get health insurance, and their jobs were canceled. And now all these actors don't have health insurance. And it's really a big, it's been a nightmare. Wow. So they're
helping those actors who didn't quite make their weeks. Especially in shows, you know, they count equity, you know, it's like 12 weeks or 13 weeks, you get 6 months of health insurance, 20 weeks of work, you get a year. And some people didn't quite make it. And who knows when professional theater is going to be around again.
Oh, my gosh.
So they're helping with them as well.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
So before we bring on Dr. LaPook, Dana, is there anything that you want to talk about Bob and Nancy here before we bring on LaPook? Any stories you want to share?
I think the set should make Nancy sing that song.
What song? What
was it Don't Make Me Over?
My God. That I was cleaning the
You were so good on that.
Oh, thanks. Mm-hmm. You know what was funny about that day, though, Dana? I think there were only two big scenes that had to be done. And by the time they got to me, they were running out of light. And like it was at the end of the day, and I was supposed to have this like dance rehearsal. So literally everything you saw in that was kind of like, okay, let me sort of do this thing, you know. Whatever it was, yeah. It was a lot of it was improv, and I recorded it first without the track. I had to go back later and sing the track to my picture. It was so crazy.
Oh, you had to match your voice to what you had already acted out. Oh, that's fun though. That's
yeah.
Cool.
It was tricky. It was, but that was fun. But more fun than that were not only the scenes that we got to do all together as a group, but when we had meals together. That I remember. I loved that. Mm-hmm. Eating and talking with everybody.
Well, yeah. There was a night
and drinking.
There was a night out because, as Dana had said earlier, and I remember this distinctly with Marg Helgenberger as well. I mean, I think all of us were in this scene where we remember that stupid softball game that we had to shoot
in the rain.
At 3 or 4 in the morning. If I'm not mistaken, wasn't that literally a 24-hour day?
Oh my
Weren't
God.
We there actually for 24 hours, almost 24
I know
hours?
That, I know Mimi Leder directed that episode. That was the 4th of July episode.
Yes, that's right.
How many and people I actually...
Like, I can't hear Bob talking.
Oh, I wanted to know, does everybody remember the first time they had to go up in a helicopter and get filmed? Do you remember that the first time you were on camera?
I loved it too.
It wasn't it terrifying? I'd never been up in a helicopter before.
And I hadn't either. It wasn't
But we had
scary.
To look like it, we had to look like it was a day at the office, like we had done it all the time. And I distinctly remember, and I had it was a musical show we did, and I had to sing in the helicopter. I've grown accustomed to her face. So it was this like quiet, emotive moment, and inside my guts were coming up and exploding through my head. And that was the most terrifying moment because it just shot straight up. Anyway, that was the scariest moment that
oh
I recall.
Oh my gosh.
I did not enjoy that.
Seth, do you want to play? You want to fulfill Dana's wish here and put Nancy on the spot and sing? I kind of.
Wow.
No, if you're going to remember it. If you're going to do that, then let me sing the theme song to the show. I can imitate Diana Ross.
There you go.
All right.
Wow.
All right.
He has that music.
Yeah, this platform is very weird. So basically, I'm just going to give you the essence of piano playing because it's going to be off timing wise. So I'll give you the essence and you just go.
So everyone else mute themselves. Dana and Michael and Jeff and Bob so that Nancy.
I was going to ask them to join in. Okay.
No, it won't work. Yeah. It doesn't work that way, unfortunately.
All right.
Okay.
So right from Through the Mirror.
Yeah.
2, 3, 4.
Through the mirror of my mind, time after time, I see reflections of you and me. Reflections of the way life used to be. Reflections of the love you took from me. Oh, okay, that's it.
Oh, but that's great.
That's really
you funny. Are shameless.
No.
You're shameless.
I know. No, wow. While I've got you all here, I have to admit that I always prayed. I would go through the scripts and hope that they would have this like secret romance between me and Dodger, and it never happened. And when I would go through the scripts and look for that and look for other stuff. And if I wasn't in a dream sequence with Dodger or had some good scene, I would throw the script across the room.
It should have happened. It should have happened.
I know. We sang together at the very end, though, remember?
What did we sing?
We sang When a Man Loves a Woman. We kind of
that's right.
Shrieked it at each other.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
That was my little tribute to you, Dodger.
Right. All right, Michael and Jeff, we're going to say goodbye to you as much as I hate for this to end. And we're going to bring Dr. LaPook. Yeah, go ahead, Seth.
Michael, we want to have a good fight reunion with you. So
we love the good fight.
Yay.
Oh, are you on that?
I love you all. Yes, I love you all.
Before you let Michael go,
I love you, Cobra. I love you all.
I did an interview.
Love you, Dana.
I've got a podcast called the Giles Files, and Michael's on the latest one. We interviewed him about the good fight, and there's some good China Beach stories in there. So you guys
there are. I did Nancy's podcast a few weeks ago. It was so much fun, and we talked about all of you.
James and Seth, thank you so much. What a delight.
Yes, thank you for
Thanks
helping
for what you're doing.
I really appreciate that. It's so great to know that you guys are doing that. So
thanks, Michael.
Anything
thank
we
you,
can do to help.
Bye-bye, okay. Michael and Jeff.
Bye, Michael.
Bye, Jeff. Love you. Bye, Michael. Love you.
Love you guys.
All right. So I would say on that note, Dana, do you want to stay or do you want, because these two actually have a connection to Dr. LaPook in different ways. I'll leave it to you. You want to take a break?
Whatever you want. No, I'd love to be part of it.
Let's stay on. So we're going to welcome not only our chief medical correspondent, but also one that happens to be for a network that Nancy works for, CBS, Dr. John LaPook.
Hi, guys. Hi, Nancy.
Bob. Hi.
Hey, John.
Well,
hi, Dr. LaPook.
Hi, Dana.
Hi.
Hi, guys. I can confirm, Bob was just talking about him singing for an episode. I can confirm that he can sing because I know Bob for longer, I believe, than any of you, for more than 40 years, because we were in the same singing group together in college. It was a singing group called the SOBs, the Society of Orpheus and Bacchus. And I hope I don't live to regret this, but I've over the years, I've kept my private life and sort of the broadcast life separate. But I am going to, for the very first time now, share some footage from my wedding with my wife, Kate Lear, which was May 26, 1985. So we're coming up on 35 years.
Oh, my goodness.
And the setup for it will just be that we got up there to do a song that we did in college, and a bunch of the same guys from the singing group a cappella were there. Bob and I, well, you'll see Bob looking a little younger, more like around China Beach time.
Yeah.
And then at the end, and we used to do this little routine, you'll see. But then at the end, we're going to end on, there's a guy named Miles Leverett Watson. Miles Watson. And he was a wonderful friend of ours, and he had a beautiful voice. And he used to sing a song called Chariot. And we were in the background there singing. It is absolutely an evocative signature song, and you'll hear one of the great voices. So I put it all together into a little clip. It's only 2 minutes, so have fun with it.
All right, here we go.
As the New Haven train left Grand Central, a young girl got on with her kids. She said, I'm not dreaming that it's come to leaving, cause this burg's about on the skids.
On the skids, the home is where the heart is. We can't hang our hearts on a nail.
So we're
thinking of leasing a quartzit or Neeson
to do
daddy while mommy does jail.
When the train had pulled out of the station, the family was still all inside. For Ann Harvard Feller had got her so mellow that she was exquisitely fried.
Assemble, Lord, to the judgment day.
I hope I don't live to regret that.
Guys, this was so great. You guys completely retained your pitch a cappella. I'm so impressed.
Well, I'll tell you a sweet song. So Miles Watson Leverett III, who had one of the great voices, may he rest in peace.
Aww.
And 2 years ago, a few years ago, we had a memorial for him. And 25-30 members of the SOBs got together. And we sang Chariot, but like the fallen military leader who the horse goes without the rider, we sang it, but with no solo. We would go, we heard it in our heads then, oh yeah, oh yeah. And it was one of the sweetest moments I can ever remember. So rest in peace, Miles. What is it, Bob, what's it like to see that?
Yeah. Well, it's to see Miles again. Again, a glorious voice. I saw him many times because he lived in Los Angeles for a long time. So I got together with him a number of times over the intervening years. A great guy. I saw him in on this island, Once Upon a Time on This Island.
Once on this island, yeah.
Once on this island. He was extraordinary. And to see that, you know, where we all look so young, it just occurs to me that that you guys have all aged so beautifully. You're a silver fox now, John. I'm, you know, it's heartbreaking for me because I still had a little hair back then. It's just a nostalgic moment. I still have the phantom hair pains. I don't know.
So
if that's an actual diagnosis.
As long as we're going super personal, there's some things about Bob you may not know.
Great. This is going to be fun for me.
So he has a rubber face, you know? And in college, I don't know if he can still do it. He could put his entire fist
in my mouth.
I don't know.
Not going to do it. You're going to have to pay good money to see that.
Wait a minute. Dana and Nancy, did you know that?
I never knew that.
No, but look at the size of my hands. They're huge, too. You know what they say, ladies, big hands, big feet, big disappointment. I have enormous hands.
And didn't we would go on tour down south and play at various colleges and stuff. And there was a Christelberger, right? Which is this kind of a small hamburger.
Dr. John is doing it all.
he could remember, well, medically, it seems to be impossible. He could put like 8 Christelbergers in his mouth.
It's true.
Why you would want to do that?
This was my early claim. Sadly, I can't disengage that, whatever that was, it doesn't really work anymore. But I, now that you've said that, I realize that the freak show option is still open for me. So I'm going to think seriously about it.
Well, Bob.
I promise, Dana, you and I will have a private lunch. Same for you, Nancy. I will stick my fist in my mouth over the table at the restaurant of your choice.
Bob,
all right.
Bob was
you
pre-med.
You picked the place.
Bob was pre-med, and he became, of course, the holographic doctor on Star Trek, but he was pre-med and for 2 seconds. And he and I did a segment for CBS Evening News of things that came true in Star Trek. And we remember that? We did that little segment together.
I do. I remember it very well. And a lot of Star Trek has posited many technologies that have come true. So that was... And it was fun for us to be together. I've gotten the best tour of CBS News from this fellow when I go and visit. So we've been friends literally forever.
Wow.
And by that he means figuratively forever.
Figuratively forever. And who do I call whenever I need an actual medical opinion? And this is, you know, when you play, I put in 11 years as a television doctor, so I still get asked by people as if I know what I'm talking about for advice. But then I just call you and give them your advice.
Well, I hope I don't live to regret that showing finally this super personal part of my life. Nobody's ever seen publicly that wedding video.
And is Kate okay with this? Was she?
Yes, she does know that it happened. I got her permission.
All right.
And as I always do. That's why we've been married almost 35 years.
He asked for
respect.
Well, I was on. Can I also say this at their wedding? We not only sang. You know who we had to follow? The 2,000-year-old man.
What?
Mel Brooks and Carl Reiner did 10 minutes at their wedding before we went on.
Wow.
I realized if I could do that, if you could go on after those guys, you can survive in show business.
Wow.
Okay, Dr. LaPook, I have to ask, who are you that you got Mel Brooks
who are
and Carl Reiner? Who are you?
You know, back then for like $50 you could get them. Yeah. They hadn't been for a long time.
They were family friends, we'll leave it at that.
Oh my goodness.
But I remember the end of that because at the end, you know, they have to get off. But they don't get off until they finally hit the great line. So Carl says, "Do you have any advice for the newlyweds?" And Mel immediately goes, "Ignore each other." And Carl says, "What do you mean?" He says, "Ignore each other. Because the more you know each other, the more you'll realize you're just like each other. And the same hatred you have for yourself, you'll throw on them." So Dr. LaPook, when you come home at night and Katie says, "Who is it?" Say, "It's Irving. Never give your real name in a marriage. Never. Once they know who you are, you're through."
Oh my God.
What do you live by?
On that note, I think that's a good one to bring on our next guest, because as you keep saying, Dr. LaPook, there's science and then there's the beauty of laughter and music. Yeah. And thank you for bringing both today.
All right. Thanks. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
And Bob, we're going to say goodbye to you. Thank you so much.
It was a pleasure. It's wonderful that you guys are doing this thing. It was a joy to see my castmates. And I love you all.
We love you, Bob. Thank you.
No, Seth. No.
Bye, Nancy. Get back to us.
Okay. So, Dana, Brian's here. So, he made it. Can you see? Brian?
Hey,
there you go, Brian Wimmer.
Oh, look at you, cowboy.
How are you?
And we're gonna bring two of your other co-stars on, Marg. Hi, Marg.
Hey, how's everybody doing?
And here we go.
Concetta. Hi, sweethearts.
Hey there.
I'm not Marg, though. Just so we're clear. Hey, Wim, I love that hair. Margie! Here, Marg!
Sada.
Hi, sweethearts. Hi. Oh, boy, was it great to see all you guys.
Yes,
James and Seth, thank you so very much, really.
Yes, thank you.
For doing this. This is just a beautiful act of love, especially, you know, in the theater community and people who watch and those who served in Vietnam. And I couldn't be prouder or more honored to be with these wonderful actors, wonderful human beings. Bodie, wherever you are, kiss my goddaughter. Boatman's daughter is my goddaughter, Mackenzie. Wim, I love that.
You know what? Speaking of that, there were a lot of favorite episodes, but one of them was when it was integrated, if I remember correctly, with actual Vietnam vets, right?
And yeah.
That had been on television before. I don't remember. I think that's one of the reasons it was so emotional to me, is that I had fell in love with all of you, and then that it was already real, and then you brought in the real vets. Go ahead.
I was told, and you guys can correct me if I don't have this just right, but the studio was asking for what they call a bottle episode because we were so far behind, apparently. And so they, in other words, just shoot something like that could be shot very quickly in the studio. And, you know, so they came up with this idea to have real vets on, and they would incorporate some of the scenes that we'd already shot. And they got that great cinematographer, Vilmos Zsigmond, I think, right? Who shot it. So, and it ended up winning a Peabody Award, that episode. And that was a spectacular episode.
These vets had already been our consultants on the show. So
yeah.
We knew a lot of them, but for me, the big moment was, I was in the elevator, we did it at the Beverly Garland Hotel, I think, in the Valley. And I was going up the elevator, and there was this woman in the elevator with me. And I turned and looked at her, and she looked at me, and we looked like twins. And it was this woman, Diane Evans, who was a nurse in Vietnam. And in the beginning of the show, she was very against the show because they were afraid that we were going to, you know, not treat the nurses respectfully in their experience, because nobody had really talked about the nurses in Vietnam before.
Right.
They had not talked about it. And we looked at each other, and it was like my doppelganger. And that was just by accident that we looked alike.
Wow.
And then Diane went on to be a great supporter of the show and created the Women's Memorial, the Vietnam Women's Memorial in Washington.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
So she was the one who insisted that the women needed a memorial as well as the men. And she fought for that. And she actually has her memoir coming out this year. So
very cool.
Yeah, that is wonderful.
So what does that mean to have consultants? Because you hear that and you see it on credits for TV shows. What did that mean for China Beach?
Everything. Especially those. I mean, when Wimmer had his leg removed and, you know, didn't have it. I mean, in war episode. And Dana in the ER, myself in the ER. Jan Wyatt was one of our Vietnam service vets, nurses, and it was imperative. I mean, how to do, how to hold any of those instruments, you know, and the machines and betadine and all of those things. They were, it was instrumental, really. They were amazing, all of them. Jan Wyatt, of course, was our, you know, for the girls. I don't know, was there anyone, Dana, for the guys? For Picardo?
Oh, yes, you had, yes. Oh. Brian, tell them about the surfer guy.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, we had a lot of guys that would come in and bring us their actual surfboards that they had in China Beach. They brought us some of the actual t-shirts that they wore there.
Yeah.
We also had vets that showed me how to use a wheelchair, what to do, what not to do. It just made it so much more authentic, and to work really closely with these guys, and they gave everything, you know. And we tried to do our best, and I think we did a pretty good job of
great job,
you know, making great them job, feel man. Like we're trying. We're, everybody was so afraid we were going to do a MASH for Vietnam, and that's right. it wasn't time to do that yet.
Right.
Yeah. Well, Mark, did you speak to any hookers, Mark?
Funny, you know, no one came forward to share any of their stories. But I remember how before we started each season, you know, with all the vets in John Sacred Young's office on Warner Brothers lot, we cram all the actors, producers, and quite a few of the vets into the room. So, and we would, it would just be like a week. It seemed like it was a weekend, but it probably was like two like full days. You guys probably remember better than me, but it just was such an intense experience because they would share their stories, and it was, we were all kind of in this, you know, in a foxhole almost together. And it was, it was such an amazing way to start each season, because it really rooted everybody in, like, you know, the reality of what we were doing. And we just really felt compelled to, you know, honor their stories and what they went through.
I remember we did that seminar before we did the pilot. And right. I remember sitting on the floor listening to all the people talking and feeling so intimidated and thinking, I have no right to play this part. I've never had any kind of experience as horrific as this in my life. Wow. And I felt like such a phony actor, you know? And I remember Bill Broyles, who was the co-creator of the show, and he had been in Vietnam as a Marine. And he came up to me later and he said, "You know, you didn't ask any questions. I'm a little concerned." And it's because I was like listening. And then by the time we did the, because I don't really ask questions unless I know what to ask.
Yeah.
And then by the time we got to the second season, I had so many questions because there were things I still didn't understand, you know, but it was really intimidating at first because these were real people's lives.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Very humbling.
The wonderful thing about going to all of these places to speak to nurses, when Dana couldn't go, they'd fly me out and I'd go to Dallas and other places to receive awards for China Beach. And then we would, you know, I met women that served there, not only in the room in the seminars, but and men as well. We went to Arizona. Everybody went out to Arizona and met a lot of those veterans. And the one thing that stays with me forever, will forever stay with me, is one gentleman came up to me and said, "You know, for years I haven't been able to look at the memories and the photographs and the letters and the notes, and I keep them in a shoebox in my attic. And as a result of your shows with the most accurate portrayal of the stories of in Vietnam, of the nurses, of the doctors, of those that were affected, both the Vietnamese and the Americans," he said, "I was able to take that shoebox of memories down and look at it after 25 years. It, you know, if you can be lucky enough to be on a show like we all were, to be on this show, I don't, you know, you can't really ask a lot more with that, especially in these challenging times."
You know, one of the reasons why I think that, a good Norman Lear show but for you guys in the hour format, and why it worked is that there was humor.
Yes.
And it wasn't all about death, and it wasn't all about the pain of being away from your families. It was real and funny. And of course, Marg and Dana, it's like your scenes were highlights. Well, you know, all of you were, but I think we may have had, we have a little clip. Let me see.
You ever see a person drown? Huh? No. Yes, in the movies. All right, so you probably think the whole world lights up a cigarette after sex, too.
I, Casey Kalowski, daughter of dark powers, silence.
I don't believe this. This is the last time I allow myself to be talked into. Little guy just didn't want to come.
Cherub. Okay, hold on.
Wonderful. Little guy just didn't want to come.
There were always scenes like that that would make you go from like the most painful scenes, and then you'd see that stuff. I mean, it's great. I loved it.
But that's what war was like, they said, you know, and there was a lot of black humor there. That's the only way to survive.
Right, right.
Yeah. We had some wonderful writers on that show, really terrific writers. And, you know, besides John Young and Bill Broyles and Carol Flint and Lydia Woodward and Mimi Peter, who directed so many of her episodes. It was just and the crew, you know, all the production heads, just wonderful.
Yeah. Family.
Great talent.
Huge family. Huge family.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And we always pick up wherever we leave off, how many years that is. I mean, it's a rare gift. And I know.
Yeah.
Wonderful feeling, you know, and I think actors have that kind of sense of, camaraderie. We're all connected with that kind of spirit, the spirit of giving and receiving and embracing, you know, our audiences and those that, you know, we can't see. But hopefully we're touching and we're feeling somewhere, you know, in the universe, and especially now. Mm-hmm. I just have to say, I have Dana, I have many, many gifts that we have, but I have the shot glass Dana gave us at the very closing, you know, party. And I, of course, unfortunately, you know, I don't have it. Lila always had it filled, as did Dana and Marg. But this is just, you know, water. But I just had to show a little
kind of. Oh, those were the days. Yeah, those were the days.
On and off the sets. We love that. We love those shots.
Hey, Dana. Seth, I think, sent you some more donations. Oh. Do you mind reading
some
more?
They're from some pretty amazing places you'll see as you go on.
Oh, cool.
Yay.
Great.
You can round them up, Dana. are you dead? Okay.
I'm getting them. Talk amongst yourselves.
Look at this nice comment. I love that the actors loved it as much as we loved watching it. That's not always the case.
Aw.
Very strange. Oops.
You ready?
Yes, we're ready, Dana.
Okay.
We're ready.
Melissa from Maryland, 25. Laura from North Carolina gave 103. Charlie from Brooklyn, 50. Adina, Connecticut, $25. Saw every episode and bought the DVD set for her husband, who loves it. Yay! Nicola from Liverpool, UK, 25. I know Nicola. Renata from Germany, 10. Oh, Diana from Ireland, thank you, Diana, 51. And Julia from Moscow, Russia, 51. Thank you, Julia. These are all Twitter people I know.
Oh,
that's great. Thank you.
That's amazing. They're watching all over the world.
That's great. Thank you.
Oh, that's nice.
And a lot of them are really young. Like, they didn't watch the show like when it originally came out. And so it's kind of amazing that, you know, you can have 25-year-olds that are watching the show because they
You know what that makes me think? Marg, what, like, for all of you, the Vietnam War, of course, wasn't just American. So, like, did people watch it around the world? Like, when you went and you traveled while the show was on, like, what was the fan interaction?
Australia and Germany were very big. What about you guys?
Didn't we the Netherlands also?
Yeah.
Wow.
Things weren't played everywhere as much then.
Got it.
Yeah.
You want to bring on the special guest star?
Yeah, but we have a special guest. German. What'd you say?
I had people coming up to me speaking German thinking I spoke fluent German because they apparently did replace our dialogue in the Netherlands, and they were carrying on for quite some time, and I just such a disappointment.
You never will.
Not a smile. Not a smile.
That's funny.
We have someone else who was on your show that wants to say hello to you. Please say hello to Miss Ricky Lake.
Yeah! Hi, everybody.
Hey,
it's so fun to watch you guys. It's
what a nice surprise! I didn't know you were
a great surprise.
For me was working on this show with you guys for that one season. I learned so much from all of you, and it was, I can't believe how long ago it was. I turned 20. You guys came to my 21st birthday party.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. I had a karaoke party. I think I have like blackmail material of you guys somewhere.
I remember singing Stop in the Name of Love.
Yep.
21.
Yeah. Karaoke. Yeah.
21.
Wow.
And I'm now 51. Yeah. You all look so well.
Ricky, I love your short hair. I love your hair, Ricky. It really suits you.
Thank you. It was a good move before this quarantine thing, because I would have been doing it under like major duress right now. So it's in my control. But you guys were talking about the helicopters. I remember I was a donut dolly, so I actually had to ride in that helicopter without the doors, and they would do those turns. I mean, it was crazy, the stuff that they were doing.
I never had to do a scene in the helicopter with Wayne Hauser. Where, because we had a thing on the show, right? And like hanging out, right? We kind of just did this stuff and not even think about, oh no, we're just on these like Hueys. And you know.
I loved those helicopters. I mean, I was only on it once. But Marg, I remember I couldn't get over the fact that you named your beautiful son. And then I did know that, of course, it was your dad's name. And then I really felt embarrassed having said, why did you name your son after a helicopter? And it was really, and she has this gorgeous son and his name is Hugh. And we would call it helicopter.
29 now.
No. Oh, my God. Say that.
And married.
Oh, no. Really?
Married. Married.
Oh, my God. Lord, and life goes on, marches on.
Yeah.
Can I say how great it is to see Ricky Lake? I remember your 21st birthday very well.
I'm going to have to find pictures. I'm going to post them on Instagram.
I was all out of the drink, so I had a cocktail. We all toasted you. We sang. It was great. Your parents were there. It was terrific.
It's only 30 years ago, because I'm 51. So 30 years ago.
You're a baby.
Yeah, a baby is right. Absolutely.
Oh my God, you guys! Yeah. It's really fun to see you all. I'm gonna go rewatch the show. I have that DVD set. I want to break it out and get nostalgic. It was the best.
It was the best.
Damn good show.
It still is the best.
And Ricky, you did one of the most important episodes.
Which one?
The one that was told backwards.
My character has an abortion.
Yes. And then ABC would never air it again.
So it only aired that one time.
Wow.
One time.
Oh.
It was, I mean, I don't think of myself really as an actress. I mean, I did a lot of acting, but I don't think I was a very good actress, but I think I did some of my best work on
You were great.
I'm a better talk show host.
Well, that dance with Wimmer.
Boatman was talking about us in the rain, that softball game at like 4 a.m.
Oh, yeah.
And it was freezing. Oh my gosh. And yet it was still, I would do it again tomorrow, you know? Yeah.
That's right. Those 18-hour days. I worked that 24-hour day, Bobby. I worked with you.
I did too.
There
I remember.
More than one, though.
We were over.
Yeah, it was more than one.
Concetta and I have a special relationship as the two Italians on the show.
the ones who ate most. No, but remember at 2 a.m, Bobby, when we had Barbara Babcock on the gurney, right? I mean, she was dying of something, some heart thing. Oh, yeah, she had a heart problem. Okay, and so it was 2 a.m. I mean, we had gotten there. We had drove into Indian Dunes, which was the pit location of the world, but it was perfect for China Beach at, you know, early morning. And then there she is lying, and it's 3 a.m. And so Picardo and I just looked at each other. I cannot tell you how many takes that took to, you know, hit that baby home, because he looked at me, I looked at him, and we looked at Barbara, and then we just burst out laughing. It was the wrong time to do any of those things, but I'll never forget that as long as we remember, Bobby. I'm not just remembering.
No, and I remember an evening in the in the bar set where Dana was in cutoff shorts, and it was probably, I don't know, it was maybe 38 or 40 degrees. She's in a t-shirt where they've sprayed down her armpits to look like she's sweating, and her legs were beet red and virtually, you know, frostbitten.
Yeah. Ice cubes.
It was just ridiculous. It, you know, it was the coldest Vietnam ever.
No, but Mark had the worst of it. Mark had the worst of it. Yeah, Mark had the worst with her little skimpy outfits.
I did. I was always wearing something smaller.
What a beautiful light. Look at. You know,
you sent these great photos.
What's that?
You sent these great photos.
Oh, I did. Yes, that's right. That was, and that's Megan Gallagher. Yeah,
Megan.
And this is a young actress who playing this character, the little girl that's on the gurney, was just so moving. Aww. There she was so adorable and terrific. Sweet. You know,
a lot of wonderful child actors on that show. Mm-hmm.
You also said this.
Yes, Joseph Gordon-Levitt played Jeff's son.
Really? Oh, yeah, that's right. And when in the future episode, these episodes that went into the 80s.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Joseph Gordon-Levitt played Jeff's son, and he was 7 years old at the time.
Oh, my God.
And he was supposed to be Eurasian, and even though he's not really, but he kind of looked like he was. But they hired him because he was such a good actor at seven that I remember saying, "Who are you?" Yeah. Oh, my God. He was phenomenal at seven years old, so it's not surprising.
Wow. Wow.
And our directors loved kid actors. You know, there's a lot of directors out there that, you know, W.C. Fields, you know, when it came to children. And but it was, our directors loved being with those kids. And those kids listened, and they were really, you know, well-behaved, I thought. I mean, especially the hours that they came in. And because it was union, and we had to observe those hours with those kids. But, I mean, it was astonishing how they were just always up and ready to go. As long as that, you know, that craft service, those donuts were there, hot chili or something, they were always ready to go, and really talented, talented kids.
The best child actor we had was the one who played Mark's daughter when the embassy is falling in Saigon. Yeah. Oh, she's on the helicopter. Shay, God, that's the best acting I've ever seen in my life by Ms. Marg Helgenberger.
Oh, Dana.
No, seriously.
That's really sweet of you. Thank you.
Well, great.
Actually, there was sort of no acting required. Just a little behind the scenes was going on. I just had my son, Hugh, I don't know, a month. I went back to work after a month. I wasn't quite ready to get back into those 18-hour days, you know? Ease into it. So anyway, it was a scene in which I was having to get my daughter on the last helicopter out of Saigon, or one of the last helicopters out of Saigon, my daughter on the show. And I was arrived to the set late. I'd gotten lost. We were shooting downtown LA, and I was hormonal, like just like sobbing and nonstop the entire day, which was required for the scene. So I can't really attribute it to any kind of technique or acting skills. It was just,
It's funny. I just did a play with a woman who had just had a baby, and she plays somebody who just had a baby. And I told her about you in that scene, and I said, "You are going to have the easiest job in this play ever."
and she did nail it every night.
She was fantastic.
I so did not want this to end, but I think we have to have it come to an end. But we want to show one little clip, and I'm going to bring on Nancy. Ricky, we want you back, and we have an idea for you to join us for future shows.
Whenever. I love what you guys are doing. Thank you so much for doing this for the acting community and all the people that work behind the scenes. It's great to see you all.
Thanks, Ricky.
I love you.
Hi, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky. Wonderful to see you.
Thank you, Ricky. We're going to bring on Bob. We're going to say goodbye to you.
All right. Thank you again.
Bye, Bob.
Bye, Bobby.
We're going to bring on Wimmer, since he missed out, if he can come on here. I saw his face. There he is.
There he is.
And we're going to bring on Nancy, because I think this Nancy is from the last episode, if I remember correctly. And it's just a little clip. Mm-hmm. It was so beautiful. Is it? Are you singing? Is that in the last episode? Oh, we put it, you're on mute.
At the wall? At the wall? Are we talking about?
I think, yeah.
Oh. Hi. Yeah, there you go.
Hey.
I think there was this beautiful montage that they did of all lots of scenes from the show. And if it's America the Beautiful, I think that's me singing.
Yeah, I don't. Let me see. It's just a little clip, and because otherwise we get flagged by YouTube and all that. And basically no one's at YouTube right now, so we don't want that. So we're just a little sample of it.
Above the fruited plain,
America. America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
Oh my God.
That's my favorite line in the last episode where it's a voiceover and I say, I couldn't save all of them, but I, killed me. But I saved some.
That's right.
Oh, kills me that line.
Yeah.
And Nancy, that was so beautifully done, Nance. I forgot that. Thanks.
Yeah.
For remembering it to play it again.
Love that.
All of us.
Yeah.
Well, love it. Thank you, Dana. And thank you
guys, Seth, James, Seth. Thank you for putting up with your husband's obsession.
Oh, no, I'm obsessed. I can't wait to watch.
He just whispered to me, we got to get the DVD.
Thank you for organizing this. This is a really great
thing. Yeah, I knew you guys would love it.
For a really great
call. Well, we did. Thank you.
All the people out there who tuned in and donated money.
What's that, Mark? Yes.
I just want to thank you guys, James and Seth, for doing what you're doing and to everybody who is tuned in and donated money.
Yes, from all over the world.
Thank you.
Let's all live in the light here, okay? Spread the light. Yeah. God bless everybody.
A reboot.
All right, we'll see you.
Bye.
All right.